If you understood the symbolism, you could read what he was actually saying when it appeared to everyone else it was just a movie. And given the scale that he used symbolism, there's no way that he filmed at a house the Rothschilds built for that orgy
and also the ending of the movie is a huge, like, what does this really mean? Like, yeah. you're supposed to look deeper into it after the end of the movie as well.
Well, I spent from 1996 to about 2001, 2002, deeply investigating both sides of the Atlantic, mind control techniques and how they work. And there are some absolutely classic scenes. In the film, Cruise's wife, Nicole Kidman.
Yeah.
She kept having flashbacks of having sex with a Navy guy and all that stuff. They all keep having flashbacks. That's classic mind control. Kubrick absolutely was putting it on a public display. But I don't know whether you know this, that he died, of course, very soon after that film was given to Warner Brothers. Mm-hmm. And Jay Weiner was saying is that and other people have said this as well, that when he gave them the original movie, the Warner Brothers executives were watching it in a theater. And when they walked out, they basically, this is this great director, is they just ignored him. They just walked past him and insisted that 25 minutes of the movie was cut.
Yeah.
And according to Jay Weiner, because of his, when he agreed to fake the moon landing shots, he thought, well, I'm going to make sure that I get a deal here. And he got a deal, it's according to Jay Weiner, that his movies could never be edited or censored again. So when they asked for 25 minutes to be taken out, he refused. And a few days later, not long later, he's dead. And they took 25 minutes out that have never been seen. And one of the reasons in the movie, there's some strange cuts because of what was taken out. So when you see what's in the movie and how far that goes, what the hell was in the 25 minutes that they wouldn't let us be shown?
It's a dark movie, isn't it? It's really dark.
If you notice too, you had this massively famed director. It was his last movie because he died by the time it was out.
Ironically, and it came and went. Eyes Wide Shut.
Yeah, it came and went. Eyes Wide Shut. What they do in mind control, so one of the great mind control techniques is use of words for confusion, where they invert words. So you'll have something like Eyes Wide Open. Now that's an obvious thing. Your eyes are wide open. But Eyes Wide Shut is an inversion. In other words, it's impossible for you to have your eyes wide shut.
And also what you said about the occult is that everything is inverted.
Everything's inverted.
Everything about it is that.
Yeah, and the other thing about Eyes Wide Shut is it's also a statement about much of the human race, which is people go around with their eyes wide shut. In fact, funny enough, you should say this, the opening introduction to The Trigger is called Eyes Wide Shut. And because the last two chapters at the end are called Eyes Wide Open 1 and 2, and I talk about the Kubrick film and the name of the film Eyes Wide Shut, and although you can't have your eyes wide shut, you can walk around with your eyes open and see nothing, which is just as much.
Which
as
is basically what he's saying, I guess.
Yeah, that's what he's basically saying. Yeah. Eyes wide shut, and what he's saying is, look at it. This is what's happening.
What about John Lennon?
I never seen that coming. Do you mean the death of John Lennon?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, in general, I find the Beatles are like quite an interesting...
Well, John Lennon criticised the running of the world, didn't he, not long before he died?
Yeah, John Lennon was a guy who had a... This is the common theme. If you have a platform and you're saying things that they really don't want people to hear...
Like Kubrick, maybe.
Yeah, then you're going to be targeted. I mean, what was Diana but someone with a massive platform willing to say things they didn't want to hear? This is the common theme that you find with people. And Lennon was obviously challenging the military-industrial complex and all that stuff.
He preached like Diana. Like,
yeah, and he was talking about the need to love each other.
Yeah.
Now, the last thing this cabal wants is the human race to love itself and love each other. It wants conflict. It wants division. Because when there's a few of you and you want to control the many, you have to divide and rule the many. You can't control a unified force. You can only control a divided force. So what they do is they create these fault lines, and indeed all these subdivisions of self-identity are creating more and more fault lines. Now we're having transgender activists and bloody feminist activists having fights in the street. Mm-hmm. All these divisions, the more self-identity groups you have, the more divisions potentially you have. And so they don't want people coming together, because, you know, when you're coming from my philosophy of life, I'm saying we're all points of attention within one infinite state of awareness. And so you are a state of awareness having an experience that is different to mine, but ultimately we are the same aspects of the same consciousness. And then when you come to that level, hey, guys, we're all one. We're all one.
It's
we're
ironic.
All expressions of each other. But what does that do? It removes the fault lines. When you get
bullshit.
People to focus on labels and identify with labels, your fault lines are infinite possibility of playing people off against each
especially
other.
Especially if you describe those labels as beneficial labels and trick people into thinking the opposite.
Yeah, you want a label called Muslim, and you want a label called Jewish, you want a label called Christian, you want a label called atheist, you want a label called transgender, a label called gay, a label called straight, and you've got endless possibilities then to play them off against each other, and everyone's fighting each other, and they don't see that a very few people are actually holding the strings of everybody.
I know of another guy who tried ayahuasca, and met DMT is basically what the compound is that right, at the heart of ayahuasca?
Yeah, that's right.
People like Joe Rogan have talked about it a lot. Dorian Yates, a bodybuilder, ironically, took it, and he said that what came to him was that everything is one, and one is everything.
Everything is one.
Yeah, we're all connected, even though you might see some dickhead on the street and think, how can I be connected to this
exactly.
asshole?
Exactly.
You are.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Because you've got your biological computer.
Yeah.
And it is decoding reality via perceptions in a particular way. And you've got someone else in a different biological computer that is decoding reality in a different way. And so when we look at the world, everyone seems to be apart from everyone else and different. But when you get to the level of consciousness beyond the body, then it's one flow of consciousness with different points of attention in it. And the other thing about that is that, you know, when we talk about oneness, everything being one, it doesn't mean we all have to be the bloody same. This oneness, this infinite state of consciousness, is all possibility, all potential. When people talk about being something that has been, is, and always will be, that's impossible. You know, you can't be all that is, has been, and ever can be. All that's describing is a state of all possibility and all potential. Mm. So to celebrate your uniqueness is to celebrate that you're part of this infinite possibility. What happens when you withdraw from that identity into a label is you stop being unique.